I'd like to call the music team, the worship team, to lead us in.
Uncle Bernie's shirt flopping in the wind, and denim jeans would feel pretty good right about now. Uncle Vern taught me a lot, and I had the privilege of growing up the road from him, and our dads working together in a farming business for a lot of years. And you know, there's funny things that he taught us, like don't eat yellow snow and don't paint electric fences and stuff like that. But there's also serious things that he taught us as well. And one thing that's been said so much today is his faith, demonstrating it, living it out, even right through all of this. As we worship today and as we praise God, I just invite you to take that faith seriously as well. I wanted to share this morning a scripture I came across. I thought it was kind of fitting and actually ties in with our first song this morning. And it's from Hebrews chapter 7, verse 19. It says, "We have this hope as an anchor for the soul, firm and secure." I invite you as we worship to hold on to it. Feel free if you're able to stand with us as we worship.
You're my God. deaf, well, I don't even know if that's an appropriate greeting, but here we are this afternoon. I know several months ago, as we met with Bernal and Darlene, and this was a rare occasion where my wife and I were visiting. I don't even remember the circumstances by which my children were joining with us that day. But it was there that Bernal asked if I would be willing to share the message today. With tears welling up in my eyes and knowing that it would likely be one of the most difficult things I would ever have to do, I agreed to do that. And I have to say today, feeling incredibly humbled and profoundly honored with this opportunity, because there is none like Bernal. In parts of Africa, when they greet each other, if you would translate it into English, it would be, "How do you sweat?" And today I would say quite profusely. Though several months ago when Bernal made this request, I had no idea that it would approach as quickly as what it did. In my mind, honestly, I was thinking, sure, when I'm 80 and you're 92, sure, Bernal, I'd be happy to give that address. But as we know, the miracle that many of us prayed for did not come to pass, except for the fact that now he is more whole than he has ever been, and he's in the presence of Almighty God. I wanted to begin to just share some of the memories that I have with Bernal. I could not share the message today without sharing some personal notes. Those of you who know me will understand that. I first met Bernal when I was 12 years old. My parents were on a 5-month mission trip to Africa, and I was placed in the care of my cousins Rick and Margaret Rose. The Roses, being good friends of Bernal and Darlene, went to visit on a Saturday evening, and I recall it like it was yesterday. I remember showing up to the farmhouse on the Zaire farm and walking into the living room where Bernal was sitting on his lazy boy with his legs up. He had just undergone knee surgery and was recovering. My first thoughts of him was that I thought he looked a lot like Lanny McDonald. Any of you who know good old hockey from the 70s, man, that mustache. I was a kid who loved to collect the hockey cards. I was like, this guy's Lanny McDonald, man. It was in that moment that I was introduced to Bernal's loud and larger-than-life personality and his infectious laughter. Little did I know that he was going to become one of my most admired and loved friends. A number of years transpired before I was reunited with Bernal and his family. They began to attend Living Waters, and I couldn't think of the exact, but somewhere in the 90s. And I was honored to be in the same Bible study home group as Bernal and Darlene. I quickly grew to love this amazing couple and their lovely children, and we spent many years attending the same small group and eventually would lead together. This is where I witnessed firsthand Bernal and Darlene's love for God and for each other. This colored every action, every word, and as a result, blessed myriads of people as we've been hearing today. Those years and memories I hold so dear to my heart. Ron and I had the privilege of spending many evenings with the Zaires, chatting and, as was mentioned, playing games for countless hours. Those game nights were legendary. Bernal and I would get each other so wound up, and I must admit it was a little aided by the Pepsi as well. And we would get louder by the hour until one of the kids would come out and share that they were having difficulty sleeping with all the noise. I just remember, and even as the kids would sit at the table with us, and just the way that Bernal and Arlene interacted with each other and with their children, that stands out for me. Thinking, that's who I want to be. That's how I want to treat my wife and my family. In later years, Bernal and Darlene would often come to our place, and we encouraged our girls to put a fan on for some white noise to drown out the racket that we made. Almost every evening ended with a game of euchre. One of our favorite traditions was to place the club and spade counters in front of Rhonda, affectionately known to Bernal as Ronders Over Yonders, at which point she would flick them across the room. And I kid you not, we did this every single time, Vern would get a kick out of that. It was legendary. Game time also wasn't complete without many Vernisms. I still remember the first time that Vern shared the rhyme, "Green are the meadows, green is the grass. Here comes that Billy Goat riding on his overcoat." And I remember, I'm like, "Vern, where are you going with this?" He referred to spades as spadeards. Diamonds were forever. If someone had a great hand, they were loaded for bear and hunting for coon. It seemed like Vern had a song lyric or a line for every occasion. One specific memory that stands out is after we watched the movie, What About Bob? In the movie, Bob, if you haven't seen it, you need to see it. In the movie, Bob, played by Bill Murray, is incredibly fearful of just about everything. So he meets with his psychiatrist, Leo Marvin, played by Richard Dreyfuss, to receive help with his many fears. Leo recommends that Bob should take baby steps, breaking tasks into smaller tasks, to begin to step out and leave the confines of his small apartment. Bob baby steps out of the office, he baby steps into the hall, he baby steps into the elevator, and so on. That evening, Bernal shared that he desired some Dairy Queen, so we jumped into their car and drove to the one on I think it's Dundas Street, I might have the wrong street, in Woodstock. Fresh off of our movie, we proceeded to baby step through the front doors, baby step up to the counter, and baby step order our treats. We must have looked absolutely ridiculous to all those around us, but we were and we mimicked what Bob had portrayed for us in the movie. Treasured memories. Another shared activity that brings back so many memories is the many rounds of golf that I enjoyed with Bernal, often accompanied by Adam. I would arrive at the Zares and I would be greeted by Jace Buddy, you know, just louder. It was always Jace Buddy, to which I would reply, Bernski! We would carry on with great laughter and loud banter on the many golf courses we graced. I always admired Bernal's game, straight and accurate. Sure, I could drive the ball a long way, but at the end, it was Bernal's consistent shot making that always landed him with a better score. I don't think I ever beat him. Again, memories that I will forever treasure. Again, I could go on forever sharing the various memories and the ways that Bernal has impacted me, but of course, that's not what I've been asked to do today. So at this point, I will attempt to segue. I wish to begin by sharing a moment that I experienced with Bernal and Darlene approximately 7 years ago. We were attending the annual weekend leaders retreat in St. Jacob's as leaders from Living Water. I was serving as youth pastor at Living Water and Bernal as an elder. It was a Saturday morning after we shared breakfast. We were all meeting together when Bernal shared a dream that he had the evening before. In the dream, he was traveling on an ATV and he was searching for a piece of land to purchase. As he proceeded, he began traveling up a steep hill, and it became so steep that the ATV tipped, and that Bernal had reached out to take hold of a tree, all the while saying, "Help me, Jesus. Help me, Jesus." It was at that point that Bernal awoke from his dream. I remember all of us trying to discern what it could possibly have meant, thinking maybe it was a message for us as leaders. But now looking back, I see the significance of that dream and how it certainly is how Bernal lived, with clinging dependence on his Lord and Savior, Jesus Christ, as he battled with weakening physical strength. Several years ago, I was at a funeral, and this story was shared, and I wish to share it with you today. It's about the most famous broken rope in mountaineering history. In the Alpine Museum at Zermatt, Switzerland, is a piece of broken rope. And it's thick. It looks really strong. And yet it failed at a critical moment in history. Edward Whymper, poor guy. Anyway, a famous woodcarver and alpine climber, had the ambition to scale the heights of the Matterhorn. You may have heard of the Matterhorn in Switzerland. It is the 10th highest mountain in Switzerland. Many times he had reached what was called the Great Shoulder on the Italian side of the Matterhorn, but never got to the top. He tried again himself with three guides and three more climbers on July 14th of 1865. Successfully, they reached the top. His goal had been reached. And they commented, "One crowded hour of glorious life." Then began the descent. They rewrote themselves together. Michael Crowes was the famous guy. Three climbers, Charles Hudson, Lord Francis Douglas, Douglas Robert Haddow, Peter Tang Walden, the guy being the father, Edward Whymper himself, and Peter Tang Walden Jr., the son of the guy. As Michael Crowes stepped over the edge and began the descent, followed by the air, he began the descent and was followed by the others. During the very difficult descent, a sudden shrill cry rang out. One of the climbers above Michael Crowes had lost his footing. He fell down on Michael and hurled him off the slender foothold. The next two climbers above them were dragged off of their footholds. The remaining three experienced climbers above tightened the rope between them and stood firm to bear the shock as one of the falling four men, to bear the shock of the men falling. The rope ran its length and the blow came. But the rope snapped like a thread. The three secured climbers helplessly saw their friends hopelessly fall to their deaths 4,000 feet to the glacier below. For nearly an hour, the remaining three climbers clung to the Matterhorn in terrified silence, interrupted by a terrified weeping. Finally, Edward Whymper was able to encourage the father and the son to begin the descent again. Hours later, they arrived in Zermatt to tell their story. The broken rope was examined. Why did it snap? They discovered it was not a genuine alpine club rope. An alpine club rope is distinguished by a red strand running through it, and this was not the rope that they used that day. How was it that a substitute rope was carried on such an occasion has since remained an inexplicable mystery, and that was taken from the Prairie Overcomer. As I share this message today, I have to be honest, I have attended funerals where what has been proclaimed has not been the gospel of Jesus Christ, to which there's a part of me that wants to jump up. There's a part of me that wants to cry out. Because I've been to funerals where they speak of a person's good deeds and how there was such an incredible man. All these things Burnell was. But today, he would say to you, that is not what his confidence was placed upon. I often think, you know, we read portions of scriptures from John 14 where we hear Jesus tell us, he says, "Do not let your hearts be troubled. Trust in God. Trust also in me. In my Father's house are many rooms. If it were not so, I would have told you. I am going there to prepare a place for you. And I will go and prepare a place for you. And I will come back and take you to be with me, that you also may be where I am." And I often hear that portion of Scripture used. But I often find that other things that Jesus said are neglected. And so as I share with you today, as a messenger of the gospel of Jesus Christ, I know that one day I will stand to account for what I shared and what I did not share. And some of you might wonder, who is this guy? What's he talking about? See, the way I can best describe it is like this. If I had a boat, and on my boat, I had some life preservers, and they were rated for up to 100 pounds, but I was too cheap to go and buy some new ones that would be rated for higher than that. And I took you on my boat and gave you assurance and confidence that those life preservers would save you if we got into trouble. That would be criminal. That would be criminal. There's this universalist mentality that has crept into our North American culture. And I cannot speak that today. But I must speak the gospel of the Lord Jesus Christ. Because like that scarlet thread that was in that climbing rope, That scarlet thread represents to me the blood of Jesus Christ. The finished work that he did on the cross at Calvary. That is the confidence that Burnell had. That colored everything he said, everything he did. 1 Peter 1:18 to 21 says this. For you know that it was not with perishable things, such as silver or gold, that you were redeemed from the empty way of life handed down to you from your forefathers, but with the precious blood of Christ, a lamb without blemish or defect. He was chosen before the creation of the world, but was revealed in these last times for your sake. Through him you believe in God, who raised him from the dead and glorified him, and so your faith and your hope are in God. There it talks about being redeemed. But you know, I like to think of that in the same way as ransomed. The reality is that sin is something that takes us captive. Sin is something that carries us away. And the greatest ransom ever paid was paid for you and I. Jesus traded his perfect life without spot, without blemish, willingly died, so that we could receive that and not what we deserve. If that is not the good news, I don't know what is. Burnell was an amazing man with a great deal of good works, but he didn't place his faith in that. Isaiah 64, verse 6 says, Our righteousness is as filthy rags. That which we can do in and of ourselves is not enough. That is like having that rope without the scarlet strand. Ephesians 2, verses 8 and 9 say this. For it is by grace that you have been saved, through faith. And this not from ourselves, it is the gift of God, not by works, so that no one can boast. And as all of us who are here who knew Burnell, with all of the good works, with all the things we've celebrated today, he was not one to boast in those works. His confidence was securely placed on the finished work of Jesus Christ. John 3:16 is often quoted. It's in the end zones at football games. But you know what? The English word does not do justice to that word, to believe in him. Because if you look in the Greek, it says this. It says to cling to trust in, and rely upon. There was a gentleman by the name of Blondin who lived in the late 1800s and would often go across a tightrope at the Niagara Falls. And he was doing more and more daring things, and people would come every day to find out what it was he was going to do that day. And one day he arrived and he said to the crowd, he said, "How many of you believe that I can make my way across this tightrope today to the other side?" And every single person put up their hand. But then he looked at that crowd and he said, "Who is going to ride on my back? Who of you is going to ride upon my back as I do that?" Everyone's hand went down. See, there's a difference between believing something, giving mental assent to something, and putting your confidence and your trust. Jesus welcomes us to relationship. That is the whole point. We get caught up in these religious actions and things, and that is missing the point. He draws us to relationship with him. Earlier in that same chapter, he says about being born again. The symbol for the Christian faith is one of a caterpillar. This caterpillar, at one time, was the caterpillar. It starts off, it is focused on the earth. It is bound by the earth. But this new birth takes place, and now it is able to fly. It no longer goes around and crawls on the ground. Philippians 4, which is printed in your bulletins. I'm just going to read this here. And it says this. I rejoice greatly in the Lord that at last you have renewed your concern for me. Indeed, you have been concerned, but you had no opportunity to show it. I am not saying this because I am in need, for I have learned to be content, whatever the circumstances. I know what it is like to be in need, and I know what it is like to have plenty. I have learned the secret of being content in any and every situation, whether well-fed or hungry, whether living in plenty or in want. I can do everything through Him, Christ, who gives me strength. That was a scripture that Bernal lived out from that personal relationship he had with Jesus Christ. He confessed with his mouth that Jesus is his Lord. He confessed his sin. He called upon the name of the Lord. The scripture makes it clear. All those who call upon his name will be saved. And then we begin this journey with Jesus. Bernal recognized that as a follower of Christ, he was a citizen of heaven and only passing through as an ambassador on this earth. If we look at Bernal's passing from only this side of eternity, then life is cruel. But we sometimes forget to look at fullness of life in light of eternity. Bernal's faith has become sight. He has been ushered into the presence of Almighty God. I have a question for you today. How about you? What climbing rope are you sitting? Your deeds, maybe church attendance, abstaining from certain actions, the benevolence of God. Have you confessed your sin and called upon the name of the Lord? Have you confessed with your mouth that He is your Lord and Savior? Have you been born again? In closing, I want to share two more items. This past Friday, we learned the devastating news that Bernal had passed away through the night. Rhonda, myself, and my two youngest daughters began grieving together before my oldest daughter was away. Typical teenager. When she awoke, we settled her down, prepared to share with her the news. As we began to share of Bernal's passing, she interjected, sharing that she already knew. During the evening, she had a dream, which she shared with us at that time, and I want to read it to you now. On the morning of September 22nd, 2017, I had a dream. I dreamt that it was an incredibly bright and beautiful day. The sky seemed brighter than normal, and every color in nature was very vibrant. I dreamt that I was outside with my family, and we were going on a walk. I dreamt that Bernal was there too. He walked and talked with us. And for the entire time, he had a big smile on his face. We were all full of laughter. I cannot remember what was spoken, but I can remember the overwhelming feeling of peace, love, and unexplainable joy. In that moment, I knew that Bernal was experiencing those very same feelings of peace, joy, and complete healing. I knew that his time had come to meet with his Heavenly Father face to face, and I knew that he was okay. The hardest part for me, if I'm honest, in my grieving is that Bernal passed 12 hours before he got to tell me one more time what he meant to me. I'm glad you did. I'm glad you guys did. I didn't get a chance. I think he knew. So today, even though I think I'm crazy to do it, I want to share. And I can speak it as I would have right to Bernal's face. Bernal Ernstein, you are one of my dearest friends, most cherished friends. Your loyalty to Christ, your family, and to your friends is unmatched by anyone I know. You exhibited love in such tangible ways. I never questioned it, and your actions decreed it louder than any words ever could. You are a trusted brother, a man of integrity that I truly admire and wish to emulate. Your commitment to Darlene and your family is so evident. I love how you get a glint in your eye anytime you talk about your family. You are fiercely protective and always have their best interest in mind. I have absolutely loved every minute that I had the privilege of spending time with you. The laughs we shared around the table as we chatted and played games have always been a highlight. I always came away from our visits feeling so loved and good about myself. You've played such a big part in many of the highlights of my life. You were an amazing MC at our wedding reception, rejoiced with us at the birth of our daughters, and loved them like your own. I love serving alongside you in ministry. You served as an amazing role model in leadership, as your humility and dedication to loving and serving people was so evident. Leaving Living Water to serve at Women's Center was not easy, and one of the greatest sacrifices was not being able to see you every Sunday. It was so difficult to watch your struggle these past few years. I know that the road you traveled was very difficult, but the way you handled it was an incredible example in the face of suffering. You are, and always have been, such an incredible blessing in my life. I'm eternally grateful that our paths crossed, and that I had the privilege to call you my friend. Love you, Bernstein. I know that you have departed for your heavenly destination, and I look forward to being reunited with you once again.
Lord, we thank you for the life of Bernal. And we pray that through faith in Jesus Christ, each of us may worship you in his death. We rejoice in your goodness and your power, in your vision and intentions, which are beyond our ability to understand. May each one here, through faith in the person and the finished work of Jesus Christ, experience delivery from death and from the fear of death, to the understanding of death as the entrance into your presence and community forever. May your comfort and joy be experienced by us all, by faith in Jesus Christ, who died that sin and death might no longer rule. We look forward to the day when death itself, the last enemy, shall be wiped from the face of God's creation for all time. God, with your whole people, we offer you thanks for all you have done for us through Jesus Christ. By giving Christ to us as our Lord and Savior, to live and die and live again for us, you have disclosed your gracious vision for creation and have shown us that your love has no limit and no end. By raising Christ from the dead, you have promised that those who trust in him will share his resurrection life. For the assurance and the hope of our faith, and for the saints you have received into your eternal joy, our hearts cry out in thanks. We lift up our hearts in gratitude for the life of Bernal, now gone from among us, for all your goodness to him through many seasons, for all that he means to those who love him, and for everything in his life that reflected your blessing. We bless you that his sins are forgiven, that failure of human health is past, that he is safe and happy in your gracious presence. Help us to release him to you, gracious God. We know that in your keeping, he is utterly secure. Surround us and all who mourn today with your unending compassion. Bless Bernal's family for the love and care with which they surrounded him. Guide us on the course of our journey. Help us to live so that we might not be ashamed when we meet you on the last day. Bring us into the community of the redeemed in your eternal realm, through Jesus Christ our Lord. Amen. There are a few announcements I'll just share with you. Bernal's family wishes to thank you all for your prayers and love and support during this time. They also wish to invite you to join them downstairs for lunch after the interment. We'd like to thank all of the participants, whoever they may have been. Want to mention Rhonda Herb and her family who did some singing at the beginning. Thanks to the East Aurora Mennonite Church for the use of this building. Thanks to the Francis Funeral Home for all the things that they did to make this possible. And if I might just share a couple things with you, the interment is next, and we will go outside for that. Ask that anyone who is not going outside for the interment would remain here on this level. Don't go downstairs. And then when the interment is over and people have returned, we will all go through that door, through that door downstairs to form a line to go through for the lunch. So if you would please wait to go downstairs until that happens, that would be wonderful. And I might just add that I have done many, many interments in this cemetery. And my 15 years at Castle Church and now a few years a year at Living Water. And never once have I had an interment where we did not experience a blizzard. So, I'm not guaranteeing you that. Let's pray. May the resurrection of our Lord Jesus Christ, by the power and will of the one Creator God, free each of us from forces that tie us to this earthly life. May the grace of God be above us to overshadow us, beneath us to uphold us, before us to guide us, behind us to protect us, close beside us and within us, to make us able for all things, and to nurture both our faith and our faithfulness with the joy and the peace that the world cannot give or cannot take away. We ask, Lord, that you bless this lunch. Ask your blessings on those who have prepared. prepared the food and on those who receive it. We pray that our discussions over that food would be worthy of your attention. May the Lord bless you and keep you. May the Lord make his face to shine upon you and be gracious to you. May the Lord lift up his countenance upon you and give you peace. Amen. There's going to be a song played, and we ask that you remain and listen to it once, and when it is over, then the ushers